Hi guys, I'm Lena Selzer. I'm here from Detroit, actually, so not far, and am currently part of an organization called Civilla. We are a center for social innovation based in Detroit, focused on working with really large institutions to bring them closer to those they serve in order to create impact, streamline services, decrease costs, and ultimately create more enduring change.
I'm Janice Cho. I'm a design director for DevMynd. We have a whole crew here that's been involved in this project as well, and we've partnered with Civilla in executing some of the stuff. We'll talk more about it.
Yeah, so today we're going to talk about a project that's really near and dear to our hearts. It's been work that Civilla's been on for the last year and a half, and with DevMynd over the past 6 to 9 months at this point. It all started in a storage closet. This is where Civilla was launched about a year and a half ago. It's based in Midtown. And when we opened our doors, there were three of us at the time. One of the co-founders, his name is Michael Brennan. He used to be the CEO of United Way in Detroit. And one of, he walked into Civilla with an artifact, which he'd been carrying around for about 7 years. While he was at United Way, there'd been a very large safety net study that he'd conducted in partnership with McKinsey, looking at, you know, we talk a lot about the safety net, but what is the safety net specifically in Michigan? Who are the players? What is the flow of money? And one of the artifacts that came out of that study was this. This is the application for public benefits in the state of Michigan today. It is up to over 40 pages long. It asks you over 1,000 questions. It is over 18,000 words. This is an application that you'd fill out if you were applying for food assistance, if you're applying for Medicaid, if you're applying for childcare, cash assistance, state emergency relief. It serves over 2.5 million residents every single year. And it doesn't take a lot to figure out that that's probably a really large barrier to services. There's over $1 billion every year allocated just in Michigan for residents that never ultimately ends up getting distributed. We think in part because of the large barriers to accessing those services. So when we opened the doors, we felt very strongly like this is something we wanted to lean in on. And as a human-centered design firm or organization, one of the things that became most important to us was understanding not what experts say or not what best practice research says, but actually who are the folks who are experiencing this day in and day out, both residents and caseworkers? What is their experience? Because for us, that really is the expert voice. And what can we learn and ultimately translate for the state of Michigan in trying to get change ushered through in order to make this better for folks across the states? In that journey, one of the things you realize is that this is just one point in a much longer journey in applying for public assistance. You ultimately end up on a much longer path. This is a journey map that currently sprawls the floor of the storage closet that walks state leadership through the process from the client and the caseworker's eyes of what happens when you turn in that application. At its least or at its best, it can be 30 to 60 days. At its worst, it can be much longer. So when we started leaning in, we wanted to lift up for state leadership the voices of residents in the state who are accessing and experiencing this journey and what they had to teach us all. One of the critical things in this, though, is that obviously we just opened the doors, so we didn't have a large team, and so we ended up just putting a call out to the community. We had community design sessions that were available for anyone who wanted to participate. We met on Thursday mornings, and people started showing up from all across the city, in some cases from across the states, and some folks from around the world in order to show up and start contributing to a problem that they felt really strongly about. In that, one of the first people we met was Latina. She is a resident in the state of Michigan. She's since become a part of our team and a dear friend to the organization. She's given us her permission to share her story. But one of the things that was most striking about Latina, she was the first person we interviewed when we went out and started wading in on this work. So we spent an afternoon at her kitchen table. Some of the things I'd want you to know about Latina is that she has a PhD in urban planning. She graduated from Michigan State. She has She studied urban planning and ultimately went on to run her own business, consulting for municipalities across the U.S. And in her 30s, about 10 years ago, she had a stroke, and it left her unable to walk, talk, and write. Ultimately, she lost her business, she lost her house, she lost her marriage, and she was interfacing with public benefits for the very first time. She, at that point, had to rely on her mom to get her through the system. They had to rely on a lawyer to help get them through that process. And she has spent, over 10 years now navigating that. We would consider her an expert in what it is like to access benefits in the state of Michigan. And her voice, along with many others, have been really critical in guiding the work of both Civilla and the team, and ultimately the leadership in the state of Michigan in order to imagine a new way forward. When speaking with Latina and others, there are a number of themes that started to emerge that really started to guide the work. So there were a lot of kind of common narratives that started to be shared. One was, when residents enter into the public benefit system, there's no clear path, right? So they're dropped into the middle of this maze. They don't have a clear sense of, this is where I'm at, this is where I'm trying to go, and these are the clear steps I'm going to take in order to get there. Folks like Latina would describe it feeling more like a muddled and cosmic force, like it's literally left up to fate whether or not they'll get the assistance that they're eligible for. Latina and others describe how dehumanizing the system feels. So you're in a really personal time in your life, and you walk in the door, and the first thing that happens is you're assigned a number, and you're referred to by that number, that case number, from there on out. So there's nothing in it that's able to meet you as a human, which is really problematic in a lot of ways. And ultimately, folks end up feeling like the Department of Health and Human Services is not a service provider, it's a fraud prevention organization. You are made to feel guilty until proven innocent. And questions on that application, such as what is the date of conception of your child? Like, there's just a point where you're wondering, like, where is this going? Is this actually necessary? In some cases, this is a much kind of more intense feeling of like, this can be a really intense feeling for folks. And then ultimately, folks describe the relationship with caseworkers can be very adversarial. So it feels like it's us versus them, and that caseworkers are the ones who carry the power. We heard a lot about relationships with caseworkers who are ultimately sitting behind the desk. So they're the folks that are, you can think of them as like the customer service agents for MDHHS. They run interviews with all the residents when they apply and are meant to be helping them to solve challenges that they're facing and ultimately get them in and out as kind of seamlessly as possible in order to improve outcomes. We asked for permission from the state. When we first leaned in, they did not have awareness that we were leaning into this project. They were not formally at the table. We did not have their permission or buy-in. But at this point, we wanted to gain access to some of the some of the caseworkers behind the desk, because it felt really important to understand what's going on for them, because they were the other kind of side to that coin that's interfacing with that application every single day. At that point, they paired us with folks in Hamtramck. This is Jeff, who he's now in Flint, but was the manager of the office at the time, and Akila, who's one of the caseworkers. We were really struck when we had not spent a lot of time in Health and Human Services offices getting to know caseworkers before this point, and I think had almost went in expecting the worst because of some of the stories that we'd heard from clients. And instead, we're met with folks like Akila, who take the work really seriously. You know, Akila would describe, I got into this work because I have a degree in social work. I want to make a positive difference in my community. If I just wanted a paycheck, there are a lot of other places where I could go in order to do that. This job is not easy on a day in and day out basis or emotionally. And yet, there was this huge gap between her and others' intentions and what was ultimately getting communicated for clients. And so at that point, realized we need to spend just as much time like really deeply understanding what are caseworkers experiencing, what is their reality, and how do we ultimately design something that serves them better. Some of the things that started to emerge when trying to understand that gap were, folks like Akila have enormous caseloads. You know, in 1999, someone like Akila would have a caseload of about 300 clients at any given time. By the year 2015, that was 750. It just went up. It's now almost 1,000. So if you're just thinking about what is her capacity to actually help the folks who she's sitting across from, if you're dealing with 1,000 cases at a time, it's very, very difficult. And behind every case is actually a family. That's something that Latina reminds us of often. So the weight on caseworkers' shoulders is very large. And then they're also sitting in this system that just does not serve them very well. So someone like Akilah comes in wanting to serve people, but she spends a very large percentage of her time servicing the system, whether that's paperwork, it's clicking through the electronic kind of document records, it's returning voicemails. And that'd be one thing if she was a data analyst, but she's not. She's coming in as a social worker. She describes feeling like an eligibility worker versus a problem solver. So her job is to determine, are you eligible, yes, no? Are you eligible, yes, no? Rather than, like, why are you here? How do we help? Like, how can I improve the situation that you're coming in here with? And ultimately, she's only able to get to that very minimum threshold with each case. She's never able to go deep. So when someone like Latina calls and needs 15 minutes of her time, you know, that application times the 1,000 cases she has just makes it really, really hard for her to ultimately serve those needs. So at this point, it became really clear that it was very important to engage the state leadership formally, because if we were going to make any sort of headway, we had to have them at the table as formal partners. And so we ended up setting up a DHS office outside the storage closet in Tech Town, Detroit. And we invited the top leadership from the state, some folks from the governor's office, and the folks who were leading DHHS at the time. And when they arrived and came off the elevator, they had chairs waiting for them, and each one had an application on it. And we said, welcome to the DHS office at Tech Town. We would love if you would take a seat and fill out this application. And when you're done, if you could submit it, we'd love to bring you inside. And they sat down for 15 minutes and struggled with that application. It was the first time for 3 of the 4, it was the first time any of them had ever been into the application itself. And to their credit, they acknowledged that and they said, you know, I've actually never experienced it this way before. They have 1,000 things that they're responsible for every day. This was not one that, they had sat down in order to deeply familiarize themselves with. And at that point, we give them a huge amount of credit. They started to lean in and they said, you know, we see that this is not working. It's not working for residents. It's not working for our staff. It's ultimately extremely expensive for us to operate. Like, what can we do? We walked them through an immersive kind of experience that helped them understand the experience of residents and caseworkers, and landed ultimately on what we call an intent map. This is probably hard to see, but ultimately it's a set of spectrums that reside in their organization. There's many more, but for instance, are you a fraud prevention organization or are you a service provider? Are you focused around the institution or are you focused around the resident? Are folks recipients of aid or are they empowered residents? Are you proactive or reactive? And we asked them, you know, we'd like for you to plot out where you see yourselves today. And they put the green stickies here are where they place themselves today. In some cases, they were actually off, especially with this one, they were off the spectrum. You can't see that last sticky. And then we said, where do you think you can be at this point in 3 years at the end of the governor's term? And that was the pink. And we reflected on that together for a bit. And we said, you know, it's one thing for you to be here. You're focused entirely on the institution. And another thing for you to want to be citizen-centric. But hope is not a strategy there. Like, you are not gonna get, that's a huge distance. You actually have to fundamentally redesign around the resident and the caseworker if you want that kind of outcome. And they got that. And so at that point, stepped them into, you know, what would this application look like if it were truly designed around the resident and around the caseworker? Not can we take the old application and debate every question and figure out what needs to go in and what needs to go out, but like fundamentally reimagine it through the resident and caseworker's eyes. And at that point, Janice comes into the picture and linked up with DevMynd here in Chicago, Latina and others, and started saying, you know, let's reimagine what this could be. What are the things that are most important to help guide those decisions? So there was a series of kind of design directives, simple rules you can say that helped guide the team. And the things that became most important were that it was short, simple, and relevant. Short was really important because every page on there is stuff that Aquila has to process and Latina has to fill out. And ultimately, the application right now is the longest of its kind in the United States. So that one was critical. Simple being, you know, folks were describing, I can read, but I can't actually comprehend what this is actually asking me. You know, the state leadership was coming through and they're like, I can't understand what this is asking. So how did we help folks not only be able to fill it out, but fill it out by themselves and have kind of the confidence that they were able to do that accurately? And then relevant being that folks are often coming in applying for more than just one program, but how do we help them understand, you know, if you're only applying for food and Medicaid, these are the pieces that are relevant to your specific case. You can leave the rest out. So it was a number of, it was about 9 months of work at that point with alongside residents, alongside caseworkers, alongside DevMynd in order to get to a solution that ultimately could be piloted. As far as cutting length, there were a number of things that we did in order to help with that. One was just pure redundancy. Are there things we can that are asked multiple times across applications, different applications, or the same application that we can take out? Can we restructure questions, ask them in a better way? Can we create trigger questions that ultimately say, you know, this is actually a more complex case. We don't have to put all of it in the application, but to encourage and trigger caseworkers say, this is a complexity I need to follow up on in the interview. And ultimately, in doing that, we're able to pull down the length of the application by up to 80% with no structural changes to policy, business process, or technology. So that was really big. And there's a lot of work that went on with the policy teams in the state of Michigan in order to help make that possible. The second part was how do we make sure that folks are only filling out what's relevant for them? And this was a really big shift in the strategy that's kind of sitting over the application. You can think of the current application as being designed for the 1%. It was the 1% most complex case that could ever walk in the door. And they were trying to make sure that they could, like in boxes, map out that human condition in an application. And so actually when you go through most of them, a lot of it's blank because it just doesn't apply to the majority of people who walk in. And so instead, the team started to say, you know, how do we actually design around the 60 to 80% most common use case that walks in and then create those trigger questions that say, this is a more complex situation. The caseworker needs to follow up in person when they have a conversation. And then ultimately looked at, you know, how do we simplify the design of the application? Because to design something simple is really complex. So when things feel intuitive, you know that there's a lot that's gone into making it feel that way. And Janice played a really large role in kind of guiding that work for us. And I was hoping that she could talk a little bit about some of the design decisions that were made in order to help it feel more intuitive for residents.
Hi. So along with our team at DevMynd, you know, considering all of this work, right, and all of the months and the people that you bring on board, how unfortunate would that be to then create a Google Doc or a Microsoft Word that, you know, format something in another way and present that without any thought, right? And this is kind of where the power of graphic design and decisions that you can kind of wrangle in all of these ideas and hope that we have in order to open up the service conversation, to open up ways to change the form to feel more inviting, right? These are all graphic things that we can actually create and emulate all of the work that has been done so far. And our team, our small and mighty design team, along with the small and mighty design team of Civilla, this is an example of a registration page of what it looked like before and what it looked like afterwards. And there are a few examples that we'll walk through in terms of like these larger guiding principles that we had in terms of how we created this. But for the most part, you can already kind of tell that they're very different. and we'll just walk through some of those principles for you right now. One of the big things, I don't know if people have, people remember when I was here last time and I was talking about this idea of like visuals really matter, and that even if you put thought into things, and I showed that really creepy, cool looking orange juice like juicer that looks really cool, but like just innately feels really wrong, right? In the same way, we wanted to make sure that, you know, like big things that we often sort of take for granted, things like font choices and color, that we can then actually take all of this understanding of people, how these residents feel, how we want caseworkers to feel, and perhaps create a way that can open up this avenue with literally just like font and color and construction of this new form. One of the things that I would like to say about the typography that we chose here, we kind of looked through a few fonts with our team, but just like a few notes about this font. I don't know how much you guys care about fonts, but we can talk for hours if you wanted. But this little font right here was designed in 2004. It has like Swiss qualities, and the designer itself created it with like a monospace kind of spirit. And the idea behind this font was to strip away a lot of like the marketing character that exists out there in the world. So if you kind of trace these things back, if you're really interested in reading a little bit more about it, it's called Accurate, A-K-U-R-R-A-T. And you can kind of dig through that too. The color piece as well, along with, you know, we were kind of struggling with this for a little bit too. And what we kind of finally decided on is, how do we even take the language of how we talk about color into this form? So knowing that our general form was going to take on the color of blue, what other colors can we say, you know, out loud, where I can immediately recognize it from just saying the word, but also distinctively sort of distinguish it when it's printed out or when you're seeing it visually? So purple. I think everybody can think of purple, red, orange, green, and, you know, one of the design restrictions that we did have was yellow doesn't print, right? So what color are we going to choose after that? When we get into like magenta, then it crosses over to like red. Orange sometimes prints out to, you know, like a very specific orange. But so one of the colors that we didn't really want to use, but we ended up using for childcare, was pink, because everyone also does recognize pink as a color too. So in terms of strategizing for design, that was a component of it. This legibility in terms of like opening up the form as well, there's this margin sort of rule that we created on the upper top and left hand side that is really fascinating, where like we, even as you were to just move it up just a little bit, it would start to feel suffocated and feel like the original form, and just that in and of itself was really fascinating to watch. There are little, one of the design challenges that Lena gave over to us was, how do you make this little tooltip hover over in normal kind of, you know, programs or websites, and how do we transfer that onto paper, or like transfer that idea somehow? One of the things that we all came up with was this sort of like right side indicator, where now knowing that the right side margin can kind of be played with, because that doesn't interfere with the breadth of the form. That was one of the ways that we sort of tackled that. This box structure is really fascinating too. I don't know if you, any UI designers in here? No? There is like this simple rule where right angles on boxes let me try to explain this to you. So it's like right angles can feel like suit and tie, and the more rounded the corners get, the more relaxed your clothes become, like, you know? So I know that sounds like a strange analogy, but that's literally what's happening when you create a box as a button. And you'll see, you know, like new startups rarely use, you know, like just pure boxes with right angles, because it's a space for them to design a way to, for you to feel immediately comfortable. It's an actual thing. If you see a lot of the Microsoft products. Those are all right angles. And then you can also see how that shifts the culture of the audience too, right? So one of the things that we did with this little box was based upon some of the design restrictions that we also had as well. We needed to create a way for people with disabilities to feel stabilized. That resulted in the line underneath. You can see that the bottom corners are actually, you know, right angles, perfect 90 degree angles. And then we took the top corners and just kind of curved it in just a little bit to create that invitation. And that's a, you know, these are tiny things that happen, but based upon all of that invitation that is that the caseworkers are asking for, that the residents feel like they need, this is kind of like, this is really what helps. And I think we believe very strongly in the utility of graphic design. One of the things as well that it helped to, do you want to talk about the scanner?
Yeah, so there's all sorts of challenges that you start to run into when you're designing, I guess in a lot of businesses, but government is a particularly intense one. But scanning, so a lot of the way that these paper applications are processed is that they're put into a scanner and they're scanned in. And when our clerks and caseworkers view them, they're actually through the scanned copy that's showing up on their screens. And so one of the challenges that emerged that we had to throw over to Janice and DevMynd was saying, the colors actually are disappearing when we scan. So how do we get color for residents that ultimately does not disappear or become really splotchy when we scan it? And ultimately we're kind of through some of Janice's really deep work, we're able to find a way for actually that blue box to fade away. So that actually doesn't scan, but the line underneath it does show up as well as the writing. So actually caseworkers are getting extremely clean, like, data, so to speak, coming through on their scans, whereas residents are still able to map the blue boxes. Really help them. We heard a lot in the field, like, the blue boxes help me know where I need to respond to something. I'm just looking, where's the blue, and that way I know I don't miss anything. So that color actually became really important. Yeah. So ultimately, came out of last fall with a new application that had been tested in the field a lot, but ultimately not at any sort of scale, and needed to be put into the live stream in order to learn, like, where does this break, where is this working, and how, what type of impact does it actually create for caseworkers as well as for clients or residents. And so that pilot, there's about a 3-month period where we were working very closely with the state to create readiness for that pilot, and we went live in January, actually. So we went live in 2 counties in the state of Michigan, and ultimately the folks who walked in the door there got this redesigned application, and through that we're able to both stress test the design of the application. So we're doing a lot of deep work with residents and caseworkers in order to understand what was working, where are they still confused, where are questions getting missed, where are things being incorrectly recorded, and then ultimately to collect some quantitative data as well on, does this make a difference for caseworkers? Is this helping to speed up their workflow? Is this making it way slower? Or is it way more confusing? And through that, we're also able to iterate on the design of the application a number of times. That was another thing that was really uncomfortable for the state. They're not used to iteration. So for instance, the typical printing process in the state is like a 6 to 8 week lead time. So we'd put in the order and 8 weeks later we'd get the printed applications. The whole pilot was just about 8 weeks. So there was no way that we could do that and actually get the learnings that we needed. And so had some amazing partners in the state who were up at all hours Sunday night, like sneaking around, printing off applications for the pilot in their offices and blowing up printers, and it was really amazing. But through the pilot, had really positive results. Some of that data is still coming in, but ultimately from residents we're hearing way more than we had expected how much it meant to them in that moment to have an experience that not only felt like it was meeting them where they were, but ultimately you know, we're reporting, I feel confident I can fill this out, I can do it in, you know, 10 to 15 minutes, I can do it by myself, and I'm confident that I was accurately able to tell my story. And that was a big deal for them. It was a really big deal. For caseworkers, started hearing a lot about the decreased time for them correcting errors. So they were getting a lot more complete applications. Those applications were coming in with fewer errors, and ultimately the time that it took for them to process was speeding up as well. So it allowed them to ultimately get through a lot of the interview prep and processing faster, so they could ultimately get a better sense of like what's going on in this case and connecting with folks over the course of the interview about what was actually going on, rather than trying to correct all the errors that had been improperly recorded. So there was also a lot we learned that wasn't working from a design perspective, as well as in some cases for caseworkers. And so there was a lot of value in piloting that ultimately. We are in the midst now of the final kind of policy reviews at the state, and this will go and be submitted to federal partners for approval. There's about a 4-month process where it will be reviewed by federal partners. And it is slated to, this is some of the team in the local offices in Eaton County, and then some folks in Hamtramck as well. And yeah, next steps are we're going statewide. Statewide rollout is slated for January of 2018, which is really exciting. It'll ultimately hit 2.5 million folks next year and be available for them. The other thing that's been really interesting is that this is just in some ways a paper application, but it's pushing on really important conversations around technology, right? Because the technology that sits behind it is the thing that's processing all the data that comes in. The policy ultimately is what's reflected in the application. So we've had a lot of important conversations with policy teams about how do we streamline this? How do we actually put this in conversation with the folks that you're serving? And is this policy actually make sense, or can it get streamlined? And then business process as well. So how does this application flow through the local office? What can we do to make that better for folks who are on the ground? And that's it.
Yeah, so I guess in doing the research behind how this old application became what it was, how long did that old application been in use, and how did that flow into the systems and processes and the policies that they were intended to enable?
That's a great question. So we have been considering writing a book about the 1171 and its history. Not actually, but the, you know, it's been in the state of Michigan for over 30 years, and it's been largely additive, right? So they're always adding, they're never taking away, and that's part of what has caused it to become so long. A lot of what's in there, different pieces have different stories, and some of that knowledge has been institutionalized, some of it's been lost over the years. So there's been quite a lot actually that was put in. You know, you can imagine a lawsuit came down the line 15 years ago, they put in a bunch of stuff. Since then, administrations turned over, people turned over, and that stuff's still there, but people aren't, you know, questioning that every day. So it really took quite a lot to understand what actually needs to be here and what's here because of lawsuits or policy decisions that have since changed and that sort of thing. I would say the dominant force inside the organization in those decisions is often lawsuits and audits. That has a really big impact in ultimately what gets put in. And there's a large conversation, I'd say more broadly, for applications nationally around, does everything need to be in the resident's own hand, or can we actually collect some of this through verification and through interviews? But obviously having someone write something down plays way better in lawsuits, unfortunately. And so that has been a really big stretch for them to say, actually, we might be opening ourselves up to audit risk or to lawsuits in order to try something new, but we're actually willing to take that risk in order to make this better. I would say the other thing on our mind to that question is how do we, it's one thing to bring it to where it is today, but over time, how do we ensure that the same thing doesn't happen, right? And so there actually needs to be kind of a lot kind of some like antibodies almost that are put into the organization to help protect it over time and to ultimately change the way that that process works, because it's not really serving anyone right now. The other interesting thing to that question is that policy is often written around that edge case, that 1% edge case. Like, you know, a good example is on the childcare. It's actually a federal requirement, but childcare applications are required to ask, does your family have more than $1 million of assets? Which is just like, I mean, it's surprising that folks in the state don't find that strange, but when residents walk in the door and they're applying for childcare assistance and they're getting asked, like, do you have over $1 million in assets? They're like, what is, like, that's so offensive, you know? But when you're sitting in a room writing policy, like, maybe that's reasonable. You know, someone won the lottery once and, like, managed to get childcare, and so they want to make sure that never happens again. But that's not the common case. And so there has to be a shift, I think, in policy and how it's written to really, in the same like iterative fashion that we might build technology, like, can we actually iterate on policy and bring it out into the field and stress test it to make sure that it actually makes sense? Yeah, it's a great question.
Just as a side note, a little tooltip thing, that for that $1 million question, we put, this is an actual question.
So when you were working with the government, did you, I assume they have a lot more forms than just this, did you find them trying to incorporate any of this thinking into the rest of what they were doing?
That's another really good question. They have a lot of forms. We're trying to get this one across the finish line right now, but ultimately, yeah, I think another really important piece are all of the letters and verifications that go out. They cause a lot of confusion for folks, and so we see a really big opportunity in trying to streamline the communications and ultimately not just how those are designed, but how they're worded, and even the kind of meat, you know, that's still getting sent out through the mail for the majority of cases. Like, maybe we could communicate through different channels at this point. So yeah, we're interested in that.
Just for information, I used to head the Illinois Health Information Exchange. I was the CIO. One of the questions I have, are you working with MyHIN? The application process, I understand, it's really, what you've done is remarkable, but even after the applications are over, the whole process of getting services, coordinating them is, I know in Illinois it's a mess, and I don't know what it's like in Michigan, but it doesn't sound like it's much better, and I'm just wondering, you know, what you've done is an incredibly important first step. I salute you, but what's going on to follow up to, because the applications is the first nightmare people go through. It's not the last.
Totally. Are you talking about the wider process that then follows?
Yeah. Getting services, of coordinating services across, especially across different domains, health and human services, because these things are tied together, social determinants of health.
Yeah.
I'm sure you've heard of.
Yes, totally. So Michigan recently had the Department of Health and the Department of Human Services merge. So they are set up now and starting to establish more of that communication across programs. And part of the integration of the application was starting to push towards that, saying, you know, a lot of the folks, especially between food stamps and healthcare, a lot of these families, if you're eligible for food stamps, you're also eligible for Medicaid and vice versa. So. Yeah, starting to look at that and also starting to look at, you know, trying to help the state see that this is one point in a wider journey, right, that a client has, but that journey ultimately is a much wider arc. And so the things that are being learned in this kind of small proof point, ultimately we'd like to see that pulled and extended through the full experience. I think that's going to be a long walk, but it's one that we feel really strongly about as well.
How much of this would you say is generalizable? Like, can you carry this? How easily can you carry this across? Because a lot of that wording is probably really specific, and you had to go over it. Like, how much do you think you'd have to go over everything?
Yeah, it's another great question. It depends on the program, honestly. So for healthcare and for food assistance, a lot of that policy is written at the federal level, which means that actually a lot of it, I think, could apply across state lines. For programs like cash, childcare, and state emergency relief, they're funded by block grants. And so a lot of that policy is written more at the state level. I think a lot of the learnings as far as the way, you know, even to Janice, like the huge work that's happened with DevMynd on design decisions and how people kind of move through applications and what's going on in those moments, I think a lot of that could be generalizable, but some of the specific questions and policy for that, for those programs, would have to be more state specific. But to be totally honest, we don't know yet. And I think that's one of the things that kind of looking forward, we would love to start to pull on, whether it's us helping to catalyze others to do that in their states, or us partnering with like Michigan and other states to see if they can translate some of those learnings.
Anybody not a dude for questions?
Sorry. Kind of along with some of the recent questions about scaling this to more forms or more states, how do we institutionalize the principles that you've learned here so that that's the default for new forms, so that like when government is making new forms, they don't look like the old way, they look more like this new way?
That's a really good question. Yeah. Do you have an answer?
We're working on a style guide.
We're spending a lot of time trying to think about that. Like, do you go wide in, you know, across states? Like you're saying, do you go deeper in one state? And ultimately, like, we don't, as an organization, don't want to build an army of 1,000 people that are out doing that. Like, we would like to be able to unlock, like, a wider kind of capacity of a network to take what we've learned and to ultimately translate to their own environment. So I don't know if you have thoughts on
like
some of that.
A lot of this color theory that we kind of explored as well, and we were deep in the trenches of like analyzing things that come out of Michigan and also things that come out of Detroit. And so, I mean, just with like custom software, right? Like you can't expect all white labels to sort of serve the purpose of every space. And knowing that this is a very human-centered thing that is birthing out of one state, and knowing that there are so many differences from, you know, two states that border each other, like I think that there's room to have like overarching principles, but I think that, you know, each state does need to come at this pretty thoughtfully on their own in terms of how they want to emulate their own culture and things that they've decided to, you know, hold as principles as a state. You know, like I was born and raised in California. I'll forever be that person that, you know, I feel strongly about this one state too, but you know, there's like different characters that I think can be translated and that should be taken into account. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I think we have time for one more question.
Hi, guys. You mentioned some design restrictions and you kind of touched on like accessibility things, but I'm just wondering if there were others you could elaborate on and where they were coming from.
I think, so our team with Lena's team went out to these offices and really kind of like nested in the structure there. So that box in the scanner is like an actual thing that needed to like go back and forth. Another, like, you can talk to me this one.
Another one that was really big that we both spent a lot of time is that this application had to ultimately be able to speak with or translate into the current electronic backend, right? And so that kind of computer system was built around the 40 plus page paper application. So you can imagine like it's actually 600 screens potentially if you actually expanded them all. And so we had to figure out a way of like, can we actually process these new applications in the existing backend in order to make both a pilot possible, but also ultimately statewide rollout possible? That was a big one.
Like federal, like we actually pulled out a lot more content and policy kept putting stuff back in. but some of the things that like then needed to be addressed on a federal level was, you know, like race and ethnicity. Like that was I think going through that was a little difficult in terms of, like, you know, that kind of conversation. We were thinking that that could happen at, like, a caseworker level where it's more intimate and service-oriented in some way. But knowing that, like, literally from the USA, they needed to have that, that was another thing that needed to kind of just, like, shift around.
Yeah, and the policies for each program are so different. So, like, in some cases, like, with healthcare, like, they tell you what questions have to be on there and exactly how they have to be worded, and there's no flexibility in that. With programs like cash and child care, which is administered on state level, you have a ton of flexibility on how those things are asked. And so it was kind of navigating all those waters, and now we look back and it seems very clear. But even at the time when we began, like, we didn't know what questions were for what programs and what related to what and what had to be on the general and what had to be on each program detailed page. And so, mm-hmm. Yeah, I was just working through a bunch of that.
And that if you want to apply for healthcare, you have to be able to give all of the information on paper form without talking to a caseworker. So that was kind of our anchor in terms of, like, what is the bare minimum of information that had to show up on paper too. But definitely, like, this software application that the group uses in terms of, like, how these administrators begin to put in content as well, I think was a huge driving force. Mm-hmm. Which, by the way, it is so sad, like, to walk into an office and to have, you know, women who have been working there, men who have been working there, and talking about this new software system that had been placed upon them, right, where it's not working, and they're literally looking up at the sky saying, we pushed it to the cloud and it doesn't come back down, you know? Like, shame on technology, honestly, for bringing that kind of emotion to a group like that who is trying to do a good job. Really, I'm gonna say that because it's like, I could not believe these women were literally talking about the cloud and saying, like, it just doesn't come back down. And, you know, and it's these files that it's, you know, we're creating technology in a way that isn't servicing humans or even the language of, you know, like, articulating that. That was really heartbreaking. So, yeah. Just had to say.